So do you like Los Angeles?
Do you like it? I don't think about whether or not I like it. I just live here, and I like my life, so I guess I like my life here. I live in Venice. I can walk my dog. I got a little pool. We're near the beach. My friends and family are here.
So how long were you a New Yorker?
I moved to New York. My family moved to New York when I was 12. Mm-hmm. So I grew up there in the city, and then moved to Westwood. And that was a shock. I was like the only pale, dark-haired girl who talked like this. I got rid of that, I guess. So I think I did, anyway. And so I'm used to L.A. You know, it's not like I live here to because of the movie business.
Right.
I ended up here because my family was here.
It's just the right place to be.
I miss New York, and I think there are other places to live. I'm not sure, but I've heard.
There are other places in the world.
I think so.
So when you, I mean, your films are very personal, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they're not autobiographical purely.
Right.
But they do seem very personal. So does taking this one back to New York City, a choice that was just the story fit, or?
It's just the story fit. I didn't feel like, oh, I got to get back to New York. I actually wrote it and thought, oh, why am I writing a story that has to take place in New York? Because then I'll have to leave my kids. And I thought, well, it'll never get made anyway. Or, you know, oh, well, I'll just change a few things and shoot it on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
But the story was so, there were so many things that were just too New York-y. I couldn't lose it.
Do you think that way about making film? I mean, it seems like you're kind of on this wonderful path of making personal films that you get made each time. Or I mean, are there films you haven't gotten made that you wanted to get made, or?
No. Oh yeah, no, I got it made.
But I mean, each time you do it, do you?
Yeah, each time I do it.
This time it's not gonna happen?
Oh yeah, I don't sit there writing thinking, oh, this is gonna be a great movie released by. I mean, I have a movie now I'm trying to get financed that I'm pretty sure we won't get financing. It's really different from my movies, and we need more money. Mm-hmm. But yeah, because each time I try to make a movie, it really seems like we're not going to get the money.
Mm-hmm.
So I know what that feels like, to not get the money, and then get the money.
So the money fairy just arrives? And
you twist enough arms, convince. I mean, Sony Classics thought, you know, that Please Give wasn't going to be funny. Mm-hmm. And that was what their concern was, that it was just all dark.
Mm-hmm.
And so Catherine Keener actually called them up and offered to act out the scenes that she thought would be funny. And she didn't have to do that, but I did have to go through the script with them. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're incredibly intelligent men. You know, I think that it's my limitation as a writer that you can't read the script and know it's going to be funny.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's maybe too vague, but I knew that parts of it were going to be really funny. And once I convinced them and showed them, this is funny here, this is going to be funny here. And actually, things in the movie turned out funny that I didn't even think would be funny.
Like?
I don't remember.
Was Anne Gilbert, did you expect Anne Gilbert to be as funny or get as many laughs as she gets?
No, I didn't think that. Like, you know, she's sitting at the dining table and, you know, the kid's got the underwear on their head and she says, you know, who is that? Is that funny? And I knew that would be like a funny thing to say, like my granny would say something like that, but it gets a huge laugh. You know, and when she's eating the cake, that gets a huge laugh. That was, I think that was improvised, I'm not sure. Or we made it up.
She's very funny. It just occurs to me, see, this is a classic thing. We haven't put a microphone on you.
No,
I'm pretty sure we've heard you through all of this, but
no.
We probably should, it's like hanging over the edge of the
That's probably okay.
There. We're probably hearing you, but better to hear you perfectly.
Yeah.
Clipping a mic on is always fun. Ta-da.
There it is.
See, if only Penelope Cruz had done that, it would have been so much better. She was wearing a wife beater t-shirt, and they put it on her shoulder. Her people put it on her shoulder.
Yeah.
And her hair, her lustrous
just
hair. Yeah, so Pedro and I. She was lovely, but outside from
She's so gorgeous. I just watched Broken Embraces.
And she seems to actually be a nice person.
A nice, smart person, really?
Yeah.
It's not possible.
I know, it's weird, isn't it?
It is, yeah. That someone can look like that.
Did you feel like you grew up in this business? I mean.
Yeah. I guess I did.
So is it surprising to you that people are what they are? And
I mean,
Catherine is kind of like the touchstone for everybody who wants, like, the earth.
That's great.
And directors love Catherine
yeah.
in this very intense, very personal, real way.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But a lot of actors, not so much.
Not so much. I grew up, yeah, I guess there were some crazy actors in my parents' lives, yeah. But I didn't, you know, you don't really know what they're going to be like until you're working with them. Mm-hmm. Is that what you mean? You mean...
Is that the intimacy of actually getting on a set and working through the...
Oh, yeah.
Doing the work?
Yeah, I think... Because personally, you can know somebody in a certain way, and then how they act when they're under pressure, or how they act when they have to be, you know, made up,
mm-hmm.
you know, or shot from a certain angle, or you never know, or insecure, or don't like the other actor. Yeah, they can be pretty nutty.
You get surprised by that? I mean, you kind of hire Sometimes. Somebody thinking, I really kind of know who this person is, and then...
Yeah, like, on one of my movies... An actor was mad because his turnaround was not respected, I guess. Mm-hmm. And so he didn't show up the next day. And I said to the producer, you're kidding, right? Like, but he's got a scene. And he was like, no, he's not, he's pissed and he's gonna be late on purpose. And I was just stunned. And I can see from his point of view, you know, how he rationalized that that's mm-hmm. what he should do, but I didn't understand that people could act like that.
Well, you don't have a lot of room for that on your budget.
No,
I
and it's never happened since. And it was probably a mistake, you know, that his right. turnaround was overseen. But yeah, there's no room for any of that. I mean, we're taking naps on the couch of the set. It's not like a luxurious environment.
Mm-hmm. So for you, is it all writing first? I mean, are you
yeah.
a writer first?
No,
and
I
a
direct
director
first,
second?
And then I write the script.
I've seen those movies.
It's fun. Yeah, I have too. No, well, yeah, I guess I'm a writer first because I never thought that I'd be a director. So mm-hmm. I hoped that I'd be a writer. And then when I went to film school, I thought, oh, maybe I can be a director. And if I couldn't direct, I would still hopefully write.
So did you come out of film school saying, I want to be a writer-director?
Yeah.
And make personal movies?
Yeah, although I probably never said that out loud. And make personal movies.
Well, I mean, was that what you were thinking when you came out, or did you want to make Armageddon?
I guess I wanted to make personal Armageddon. Smaller yeah, personal yes. Armageddons. Emotional Armageddon.
Those moments are there.
Yeah, I guess. I wanted to, you know, tell my stories. I didn't know how many stories I'd have in me. I knew mm-hmm. I wanted to tell that one when I got out of film school, Walking and Talking. And it took many years later.
So does it evolve naturally with your life changing? I mean,
yeah.
I kind of wondered in this movie whether... You know, the passing of Mr. Jaffe was mm-hmm. part of the choice to deal with parents passing and all
mm-hmm.
that.
I know he died right after we finished shooting.
Oh, so.
But nevertheless, I mean, parents aging for sure, yeah. and my grandma dying a while ago. And just getting older myself, I think. I didn't know I was going to write a movie about this until I'd written it, really.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really plan it. But I think about death all the time.
Hmm.
Now that you have a child, maybe you do too. It's a horrifying prospect, isn't it?
Well, it changes everything you see in the
like
media and whatever.
Your little boy is going to be 60 and you won't be here.
Yeah.
Right? Isn't that weird?
Well, my mother's first reaction, who is 79 or whatever she
mm-hmm.
is now, was that, you know, we now have a family member who will live into the next millennium. It was like the first words out of her mouth.
But
not
bitch.
Next millennium, I guess. But the next
no,
century, the
right,
next, the next
right,
century.
Right.
I'm like making him a little older
yeah,
than he is.
He's going to be 1,000 years old.
but they don't actually see
yeah.
2100.
Right.
It was her idea of like.
Right. That's the
important.
Idea of the birth of her grandchild.
Yeah.
She sounds weird.
Yeah, she's weird. Well, you know. That's why I'm doing this. I'd have to make personal
right.
movies. Otherwise, it'd be horrifying. So I'd like Doug Block do it for me. I'm at 51 Birch Street and all that stuff.
Who?
Doug Block. He's a documentarian who. Made movies about his family.
You know,
pretty.
I don't believe in documentaries. I'm joking. Didn't I say it in a jokey way?
You're close.
You
well,
look,
that's,
you
well,
look
you're,
so hurt.
Well, you don't always know where to go with that.
Yeah, I guess.
Because I didn't really believe you, but
yeah.
yet I kind
like,
of
could
thought
really
it was possible.
Something?
Do you like documentaries?
Yeah, I love documentaries.
What kind
I don't
of
believe in them, but I like them.
What kind of movies do you like generally? What are your...
I guess more character-driven, you know, indie movies, probably.
Mm-hmm.
I love the Coen brothers. I mean, I love all kinds of movies if they're really good, right?
Yeah. I do. But like the Coens are a lot more tricky than you choose to be as a filmmaker, I would say.
I couldn't even try to be as tricky as them and clever. And they have such diverse stories to tell. You know, I don't know. I'd like to be able to get outside of my own navel gazing and write about other things. But I seem unable to at the moment.
Well, is it hard to do that in terms of, or are you even conscious of it, that, you know, you've had so much success doing the navel gazing? I mean,
I know.
If that's what it is?
Well, I feel like, yeah, it's not broken. You know, why try to fix it? And yet, yeah, I guess. I mean, if I only make this kind of movie and I can make them and enough people see them, then I've done it. I don't have to do anything else. But I guess I'd like the challenge of doing another kind of movie.
Are there specific filmmakers who inspire your work, or
that I try to copy?
Well,
the Coen brothers. Certainly movies that I grew up watching by, you know, all the great filmmakers. Like, listing them always feels kind of cliche.
Yeah.
But
did you watch the Z Channel as a child, or were you watching?
Of course. Well, as a child, I saw the regular movies a kid would see. I guess I saw a lot of, I don't know, I better hurry up and say something.
Freaky Friday?
Editing. I saw movies that, like, scared the shit out of me when I was a kid. I remember Picture Mommy Dead. I remember my parents. That's a real movie, right?
I don't know.
My parents had a projector in our living room, and we showed all the Woody Allen movies, and, like, I would have a party. I think my 10th birthday party, we showed Sleeper, maybe. And
did Woody show up?
No.
Oh, okay. That would be like a really special.
What?
You try to get Woody to actually come to L.A.
Yeah, exactly. No, we were in New York.
In New York, even easier.
But
come across the park.
Yeah. He was over at our house sometimes, but not at my 10th birthday party. And my parents would show movies to their adult friends at night, and I remember that they were showing Picture Mommy Dead. And I came out in my nightgown and saw it, and I was just wrecked forever. I peaked. Jerry Lewis movies. My dad liked to take me to those. And W.C. Fields movies. I saw a lot of those when I was a kid. And, you know, and then older, just the regular kind of film student movies like Scorsese and Truffaut and Fellini and Buñuel and all those good movies.
Was film school critical to you being able to do what you do? I mean, was that a great, great experience, or was it?
It was both. It was like a lot of tears and a lot of pats on the back. I remember this one teacher. She was so awful. I hope she's watching this right now. I don't remember her name. Oh, yes, I do. Yes, I do.
She can be Googled.
I know. She's probably dead. Okay. And she was so mean. I remember with Walking and Talking, she said, it was mean only because, well, she said, this is obviously a movie about lesbians. And she was a lesbian.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not like the worst thing to be called was a lesbian, but I wasn't, and that's not what the movie was about. And she said it really, really nasty, and she didn't like it, and it had no plot. She was really mean. I remember having tears, crying from her. So film school could
be. And is that Columbia, New York, NYU?
That was at Columbia. Mm-hmm. And that, so film.
We're getting closer to who it really is.
What? Yeah, exactly. You can find out, figure it out.
Sure.
And it's brutal because, you know, they all have opinions and they're paid to have opinions, your teachers and your fellow students telling you how shitty your stuff is. I guess towards the end, and I got better at what I was doing and probably a thicker skin.
Did you have a sense of being, of knowing the real business versus knowing being in school, or was it just very personal and close? And
no, when you're in film school, it's just film school.
Right.
You know, that was the world.
For me, it wasn't. That's why. I went to NYU film school.
Oh, you did?
In the early days of Tisch.
Oh, like Nick Tanis and Sight and Sound, and
yeah.
Oh, you had Hank Mnuchin.
No, he was. I think he had just.
What are you, 80?
No, I mean, well, maybe Hank. I think it's a
Haig. Isn't that his name?
Haig.
I didn't have him.
Sorry. No, I was like
Haig.
In the Cam Galana era.
I don't know who that is.
She works for New Line,
or now
she works
Seidelman?
For Warner Brothers. Seidelman was already making movies.
Oh, okay.
She was. I guess I.
Oh, you're young.
I'm a baby.
You're younger than everybody.
But back then it was only one building instead of the entire Greenwich Village.
Is it now? Because when
they own the 8th Street Playhouse, they own the theater on 8th Street that's like on the other side of University that was a public house and now NYU owned. Yeah, they like bought everything.
Wow. I went there for a year and a half at the end of college and in the film department. And did you sleep outside that building to get equipment and everything too?
No, I was not. I was wanting to be a producer at the time, so which is something you can't really do at film school, I found, at least in my film school. So I was kind of doing things uptown. I was leaving school a lot.
So you were part of the real world when you were in film
school? I was very conscious of the real world, and I was very... It was a bit of a head spinner because they all tell you you're going to be a director, and in your case, you were. You became one. I didn't really want to be one, so. But yeah, it was a kind of like fanciful idea of what the world was like. So.
Yeah.
Different experience. Yeah.
It's very insulated and very different when you get out.
Were there films being made that were like Walking and Talking? Were there other films in the marketplace that fit, and she hated all of those, or?
Oh, I don't know. She just hated me. But there were a lot of films. I mean, there were films were starting to be made that I wanted to make movies like. That didn't make sense, but you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I saw Sex, Lies, and Videotape when I was in film school. So I was like, oh my God, I am doing the right thing. You know, somebody got this made and is making a lot of money and everybody loves it and I want to make a movie like that. So I did have some guidance. And Jane Campion had made a couple of movies too by then. And I volunteered at the New York Film Festival and, got to see a lot of independent movies that, when I was in film school in New York, that made me think it could be possible.
So when you actually got behind the camera as a director, are you obsessed or interested in or terribly concerned about the shots and things like, I mean, are you sitting there storyboarding things out, or are you trying to create a live event on the stage and
shooting
it?
You mean now, when I work?
I guess, well, one from the beginning or now? Or?
From the beginning, I felt like I was supposed to know all about foot candles. I mean, they teach you everything in film school, and I thought that's what you needed to be a director, or else you look like an asshole if you don't.
Right.
Especially being female, I felt like, well, if I come on the set and go, I don't know, just put that long lens thing on, you know, then I'd be... sabotaging myself. And yet that's actually kind of how I've turned out, because I don't care what people think about me anymore, and I just say, just put that long lens on, and he'll say, well, you know, this number, and I'll say, oh, I think this number, or show me and I'll pick. I don't feel the pressure anymore to know the stuff that doesn't really interest me, like all of the lenses or the colors and the filters and the I feel like I know enough, and with each movie, I want definitely for them to look better and better.
But you're not really worried about crane shots. Got to have a crane shot in the second act.
Well, not for the purpose of having a crane shot.
Right.
I can't even write that way anymore because everything's so low budget. Like, I'm so used to just putting people in a room and having them talk that. Like sometimes I do a job for a studio, like a rewrite job, and they say, you know, these characters can leave the room. We do have like $40 million to make this movie. You can have, you know, camera angle above the house, go, or, so I'm just so accustomed to cheap movies.
But that's what people, I think, are, I mean, your special effects,
right?
I think, are your actors.
Right, they're pimples. Those are my special effects in this last movie. Was the fake pimples?
Yes, but I mean, it is the intimacy. It is the, I mean, if you tried to do the other stuff, it might be amusing to look at that from a DP standpoint. But it's not the things we remember from your movies are those moments of insane intimacy that you generally don't see in films.
Good, yeah. I just directed recently directed an episode of Bored to Death, and there's this amazing crane shot, and it was like, when's the crane shot going to be over? You know, I have nothing to do with that.
Right.
You know, I can say started here and ended here, and then 5 hours later, the crane shot's done, you know, and it looks great, but it's definitely not what I'm there for.
So is it fun to do other stuff that's not your personal stuff?
Yeah, it was fun.
Because it's freeing or because it's...
Yeah, it's a little freeing to get out of my own work. I like working with new actors, if they're nice. And if the crew is a happy crew, it's a nice place to sort of visit for a while. At this point, you know, they want me there, so I don't have to prove myself, really. And if I like the show, it's great. Because mm-hmm. then I want everyone to be happy with what I'm doing, and it's funny, and we're laughing, and it's, yeah, I like it.
Do you get surprised by what they call you in for say, rewrites or whatever, or you, is it...
No.
Have you been boxed in that way?
I've been boxed in.
So they come to you looking for smart women talking fast?
Yeah. yeah. Or not so smart women
right.
talking fast. yeah. And I get sent those kind of scripts to direct sometimes, too. But not I haven't found anything yet that I really loved enough. I mean, there was one thing, but I couldn't end up doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But... yeah, romantic comedies, maybe with a bigger hook than what, you know, I would come up with. And they want, you know, dialogue polish and mm-hmm. make this female character more human, things like that.
So is that just a muscle stretch or just cash or?
It's good money, really good money.
Yeah.
You know, it is a muscle stretch. I wouldn't do it if I didn't have to make money. I would just write my own stuff.
Right.
But as jobs go, it's a great job, especially because I do pick a script that I can live with for a year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not like I take one that I hate. I take one that I like.
So in this case, you have a teenage girl.
Yeah.
Your kids are, I gather, 12 or so. And you were a teenage girl at one point. Is that, where did she come from? Because she is, I mean, as much as her parents are the center of this and the grandmother is at the center of this, there's this girl really, I think, is the emotional middle of this movie.
Mm-hmm.
So where did she come from?
I guess she's me, because she just kind of popped up out of nowhere. She's not based on anyone in particular. I have a niece, a 17-year-old niece, and I do hear a lot about her arguments with her mom, and I think that without being conscious of it, that's how it ended up in the script, although that character's nothing like my niece. And I had terrible skin as a teenager. It took over my world. You know, I still had a pretty good teenagehood, but it was all about the zits for a really long time.
Mm-hmm.
And before I knew it, you know, that character was just talking to her mom about zit medicine, and I don't know. I got along better with my mom, I think, than they do in the movie. My mom did have more compassion for me without me having to go, hey, without me having to make a movie about it, but... I guess that's where she came from.
Well, I kind of got also that she would, for me, that having Oliver Platt as her dad, I mean, in some ways, she is stuck with his genes besides just her skin.
Mm-hmm.
She also isn't, you know, as sleek as Catherine
right.
And has to kind of live with that. And it's kind of, there's just all kinds of areas where you're sympathetic, and she is beautiful, and she's also not in certain ways. And she, I mean, it's...
It would be hard to have Catherine be your mother if you were a daughter. And you didn't look as beautiful as Catherine and as glamorous, you know? I mean, I didn't want to cast.
Well, she's trying so hard not to look that way.
Right, you think?
I think I think in this movie in particular, but I mean, sometimes she glams up, but she's not really, I never get the sense, I rarely get the sense with her that she's trying to look beautiful and glamorous.
Right.
She just
if anything,
has
she wants
bone structure
to kind of,
and everything else.
Right, right.
You know?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's hard to be stuck with that. Or without it, I guess.
I know. And not really on purpose. I mean, I didn't want to cast, you know, a model for a daughter.
Right.
Definitely not, because I knew I was going to put the zits on her face. But, I think she looks like Catherine and Oliver, you know?
She really
like
does.
She could be their kid, except she's short, and they're not short.
Huh.
But can't have everything.
So was she cast after them?
Both? Yeah. Yeah, she was cast kind of pretty late. I auditioned a lot of girls.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of good girls. But when she came in, that was that. Her whole face and neck broke out in a blush that I'm probably in right now because I'm on camera. Hope not.
You look fine.
yeah, will you tell me if there's like something weird hanging?
I'll tell you, anything falls into, anything drips, I'll let you know. I'm very big on dripping these days.
Really?
Three-month-old at home.
Yeah, exactly. If I just start to drool. I remember that when my kids had, till he was really old, it looks like it was always wet right here.
And usually me
and
as
in
well.
And in here, yeah. What was I saying? Oh, she flushed.
Yeah.
And I love that, you know, because she was so present. You know, she was doing the scene and, like, yelling at the casting director.
And where did Rebecca come from?
England. Jeannie McCarthy, the casting director, said, oh, I think this girl's, she's kind of hot right now, which can help.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she's great and lovely and you should meet her. So I met her and then I watched Starter for 10, which she's in.
Mm-hmm.
And that was that. I was sold. She was perfect.
And she kind of also was an interesting match
with her sister, Amanda.
Because they do look like sisters, even though they don't look anything alike.
That's just the magic of fake relationships.
Maybe.
Because they don't look remotely alike.
No. But you could kind of see where, like, two different parents would, you know, like, there'd be, like, the different nose and the different...
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, I'm thinking about Rebecca's accent the whole time anyway, so...
Oh, good. You were really involved in the movie.
Well, no, not the whole time. I do this for a living, so...
She did it pretty well.
Yeah, no, she did great.
Yeah. There's one line she says... But, you know, Rebecca should have looped it. I think we tried. She did a great job.
And Anne?
Audition. Same.
Just really an audition?
Yeah, because I didn't know of her.
So what is an 80-year-old casting call like?
Oh, it's weird. I didn't actually meet her. She had been put on tape and it was sent to me. But I did audition a ton of older women. It was weird because they would come in and I'd think, that's her, she's perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And she'd talk to me and we'd have a nice conversation, and then as soon as the video camera went on and she'd start reading the scene, she started acting like an old lady.
Mm.
Like how an old lady is supposed to act. Mm-hmm. And so it was not real. You know, like, oh, well, I'm gonna talk like this and then I'm gonna talk like that or be feisty or, and it, you know, it is my fault that I didn't direct them more. I could have said, you know, you're already 90. You don't have to act 90. But I wouldn't have said that. That would have been bad. But something similar. I just was going with someone who's really natural. And it's not that Anne didn't need direction, you know, but she just got it.
Well, I guess they're actors who are of that age. They've been around long enough because of their acting still. They must have done something that they, like, have their shtick.
I know, right. And they kinda think that's what you want.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I'd say to Jeannie, I was like, you know, who was that actress that was so fake? Who was that person? And she said, oh, she just won the Tony.
Right.
Be like, what?
Yeah.
Doing that, you know, exact thing, which, you know, is the opposite of what
it's
I
was. It's like Marty Short is doing Damages this season, and he's actually acting. And you're like, and I appreciate him more, I think, now than I ever have before.
Is he good?
All the energy is great.
Yeah.
But when you see him stripped of all that shtick.
Right.
It's like, oh, look, he can, you know, you see stuff in his eyes, and you're... Mm-hmm. You're having a real experience with him as an actor, as opposed to, ta-da, which is
Jiminy
fun.
Jiminy Glick.
Yes.
Which is Jimmy Glicker,
So I see this fantasy that you knew Anne as a child. And.
Oh, really? She's my grandma.
Did you grow up with her as a child?
Yeah.
Did you know who?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I watched the Dick Van Dyke Show, and when I saw her, I was like, oh, my God, that's Millie Helper, and... And then she'd do these things on the set, you know, like laugh a certain way and kind of go like that, which was, it's like, oh my God, that's her. And it's like, yeah, that's her, because that's still her.
And she has no fear, apparently, of being, I mean, because she's, it's a tough character a lot of the time with her menopause red hair and all of that. And she really kind of like lets it loose.
She didn't care. I went to her house the other day and we were just talking about plastic surgery and, you know, how crazy she thinks it all is and how she doesn't mind looking wrinkled. And she's a lot more attractive in person than she is in the movie. She has, like, soft gray hair and she's always laughing, you know. So she's great looking.
Well, I guess her career was being Vivian Vance early on.
Right,
you know, she chose that role that she was pretty good woman. I mean, beautiful woman, young woman. But yet she was a sidekick next to Mary Tyler Moore. It's kind of tough to...
Yeah.
To shine that way.
I know, and Mary Tyler Moore, beautiful.
Yeah. So.
How do you remember what to ask me?
I don't. I'm trying to have a conversation with you. Is it working?
Yeah.
Are we chatting?
It is
that going well?
Oh my God, there's a camera here.
I know.
It's I was so relaxed.
Damn it. It's like being at a bar mitzvah and having, you know, doing the wrong thing at a table and getting caught with a video camera.
Right.
So you go through the process of making this movie. Does it change much? I mean, is it pretty much you just shoot what you wrote on the page and then edit what's on the
I would say mostly it stays the same. Things change all the time, like that line when he says, "How's that cake, Andra?" you know, which gets such a big laugh in the movie, and that was you know, like we were shooting the scene and making so many jokes, mm-hmm. and that was one of them that maybe Oliver said, and I said she should say dry or shitty or you know something, and that one stuck. Oliver Platt had a lot of ideas when he read the script that he wanted to change, and a lot of things mm-hmm. about his character that really improved it. Like the scene when they're at the dinner table, they're at a restaurant. It's the only mm-hmm. scene they're in a restaurant, and Oliver sees the guy and says, oh, that guy looks like the kid's grandpa, mm-hmm. because he's questioning kind of how he looks and his aging, and he completely made that all up in advance. I mean, thank God.
Right.
I wasn't like, oh, I have an idea at the last minute. He gave me, you know, we would talk about the scene, and we were trying to figure out the best ways to express that character's unhappiness at the time.
And was it important to making him likable in the end?
Yes.
I mean, because that was probably, I think, maybe the hardest line to walk. Mm-hmm. I mean, Catherine is mm-hmm. in her own space, and you understand mm-hmm. why she's having some hard times with certain things. But
right.
his character really kind of...
It's less explained.
Yeah.
And he does a bad thing.
But you believe him and think in the end that he
good.
Is going somewhere better or
good.
Wants to or
yeah.
has learned a lesson or...
Yeah. Good. I think so, too. And I think Oliver had a lot to do with that. You know, the performance and how we rewrote it together. Mm-hmm. So things change along the way always. And it's funny because I just was looking at the script, the last version of the script, and, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of things that are different. Mm-hmm. I rarely remember how they got different, but they did.
When award season comes around, they'll send out the script with the way it is.
Right, that's right.
Instead of the way it was.
I know, right?
Yeah.
The shooting script versus the actual script.
They made that mistake years ago with Road to Perdition, where they sent out the shooting script that was better than the movie.
Oh my God.
And you can kind of tell the things they had cut out of the movie that were really kind of good. And
yeah.
You wish they were there.
So that's why they do it now.
I think they always just,
transcribe the movie.
Transcription is much safer.
That's not so fun to read. I know.
And does somebody like Amanda Peet come in and just say, give herself over to you, knowing that you've made so many pretty actresses into something more complicated?
Yeah, she wanted me to mess with her early on. I mean, she'd auditioned for Lovely and Amazing, and I really liked her and wanted to work with her over time, and I knew she wanted to work with me too. And then this part came up, and it was like, she'd be great. And you have to be orange, Amanda. Is that okay? She was great. She would do anything. Mm-hmm. She's a big clown and really great on the set, and she's such a champ, those sex scenes. She's a pro. Really a pro. I was more embarrassed than anybody. They just went right at it. And they were clothed. I don't, you know, mm-hmm. I'm a prude, I guess, but she's great. Just right for it.
So it sounds like it was a love fest all around.
I know. Don't all movies sound like love fest? Doesn't make you want to throw up. They come to my house every night. We play poker.
And nobody ever loses.
Right. We all look amazing. It kind of was a love fest. Sometimes it was really stressful and miserable.
And then when you go through this process where you have to go out and sell it?
Yeah.
Is this something that makes you happy?
No. Am I allowed to say
You're
that?
You're absolutely allowed to say it.
No. This is nice because we're having a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
The interviews and stuff, I mean, I want to do them. I want to reach an audience, and I want to reach as wide an audience as possible for once. So I'm willing and happy to do it. It's a good job. I just have to remember it's part of my job.
Right.
I don't have to enjoy it.
Do you mind explaining what you were thinking when...
That's hard.
Is it hard artistically or personally, or is it like Michael Haneke very specifically will not explain things because he wants the audience to do that work?
Right.
Is it that kind of thing?
It's like you made a movie. Why do I have to, like, I'm not doing a monologue.
Right.
Right. I'm not that.
We should Twitter through every moment of the movie.
I think it's hard. It's not like I think. Like there's a moral thing or an ethical thing that I guess he might feel, you know, more strident about. Yeah, he's German, exactly. It's just really difficult for me to do it, to explain things. That's why I wrote a scene about it, is because I can't explain it that well. I can explain it this way. And there's so many answers, and I often feel inarticulate. especially when someone says, like, what's the ending mean? It's like, well, if you watch the whole film, you know, that's where it lands. It's hard to separate an ending like that.
Yeah.
So that's difficult. But
and your films don't really end in that.
Well, that's why I get that question.
Definitive way.
That's why I get it. Like, well, what does that mean?
Yeah.
That's should
kind
every
of the
parent,
pleasure of the film.
Well, thank you. But does that mean I have to go buy my kid those jeans? Seriously, I just read. Yes, that's what I'm telling you to do. And I get 10%. I just read an article that said, I really liked the movie, but at the end I kind of felt like the whole thing was just to justify spending $200 on a pair of jeans for your kid.
Huh.
I was like, that's so stupid. Don't send me those.
Yeah.
So I was like, I don't want to see those.
And how much are the jeans you're wearing right now?
I know.
That's a good junket question, isn't it?
I know, it is. What are these? Too much. But I'm a grown-up.
That's right. You've earned your money.
That's right. I'm not growing anymore.
It's not going to change. Your size is not going to change.
Right. My shoe size.
At least until you start shrinking, in which case.
I think I have.
We're all a few years away from that, I think.
Yeah, I am. Not.
Anyway.
Yeah.